This morning we have come to a hill called Calvary. Calvary, the place of curse for Christ, the place of blessing for us. Calvary, where we see man at his worst, but where we see God at his best. Calvary, where the Lamb of God was slain for the sins of the entire world. Calvary, where the Son of God gave his life for you and for me. Calvary, where we see the awful depths of human sin and the glorious heights of God's love. Calvary is the place where time and eternity collide in the cruel crucifixion of Jesus. Much has already happened up to this point. Jesus has been arrested while praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. A mock trial has been conducted during which the high priest and the Pharisees have accused him of stirring up the people with his teachings and his actions. He's been taken to Pilate, to Herod, and then back to Pilate by those who want to see him crucified. I find it of great interest that just 4 days earlier, Brother Dave, the crowds lining the streets of Jerusalem were crying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Yet just a few days later, that same crowd is crying, "Crucify him, crucify him." How fickle humanity is. He has been scourged, he's been beaten, his beard has been plucked out, and a cruel crown of thorns has been placed upon his head. He's been ridiculed, spat upon, and treated with such cruelty that now he hardly resembles a man. He's been forced to carry the very cross on which he will die. The torture and agony that Jesus experienced that day are more than our minds can possibly comprehend. His hands and feet are nailed to the cross. He is then suspended between heaven and earth. The unrepentant thief mocks him. The soldiers gamble for his clothes, and the crowd laughingly asks for yet another miracle to be done. And then, above the sound of all this, Jesus begins to speak. The same voice that had thundered on Mount Sinai was now crying from atop Mount Calvary. I've often wondered, Brother Ron, if at that moment, if the legions upon legions of angels in heaven are standing, gazing down upon this little planet of his, listening intently to a word that might be uttered from their commander-in-chief, from the captain of their hosts, listening with swords ready, wondering, will he bid for us to come? Brother Ron, the song says he could have called 10,000 angels to deliver him that day. I've often wondered, are they standing at attention, Brother Brad, just waiting, listening for him to command them to move? What do they hear? All it would take would be a simple word from their lips, from his lips, from their Lord, from the King of Glory. They would vacate heaven and they would take care of the whole situation then and there. They wait for the command from their captain. He then raises himself up, which in itself would have been painful. He speaks the first of seven sayings from the cross. Oh, but what is it that he says? After having suffered such agony and horror at the hands of sinful men, just what does he have to say? Does he call for the angels to deliver him? Does he demand that every atom in the bodies of the soldiers fly apart? You say, Pastor, you're getting a little bit far out there with that sort of thing. No, by him, everything exists, consists, has its very being. Jesus Christ is the one who holds all together. Does he demand for every atom in the bodies of the soldiers to fly apart at that moment? Does he tell his father, humanity is not worth it? No. Hanging there that fateful afternoon, Jesus cried out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. For the next few moments, we're going to take a look at exactly what was said in this first statement that Jesus made from the cross. And I invite you to follow along with me as we study, Father, forgive them. The first point to which I want to call your attention this morning is the fact that his first statement from the cross is a prayer. We can see this as we look at Luke 23, 34. Look at the phrasing again in this verse. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The first word in this statement is Father. This could be called the invocation. For in using this word, he is invoking the presence and help of his Father. Think with me about this for a moment. I believe it's on your study guide this morning. His public life began in prayer, and now it closes in prayer. While on the cross, at that desperate time, at that dark hour, at that moment even when his disciples had deserted him, he prayed. His faith in his Father had been unshaken by all that he had endured. They had captured him at a place of prayer. Think with me about this truth for a moment. They have shifted him from one unjust trial to another. They have spat upon him. They have nailed him to the cross. And yet, he still knew that his Father was on the throne and that he would hear his prayer. Well, this was not the first time that he had prayed to his Father on behalf of others. While in the Garden of Gethsemane, he wept as he prayed. Take note of this fact, please, this morning. According to the Scriptures, the intensity of his prayer was so much that his sweat became as great drops of blood. Just for whom was he praying? Again, Brother Brian, I've wondered, for whom was he praying? It has been said in song that while he was on the cross, I was on his mind. And while that is most certainly true, let me take it just a little bit further, if I may. For you see, long before he was on the cross, Brother Darrell, I was already on his mind. When in the Garden of Gethsemane, as he was praying for me and he was praying for you. But let's go back even before that. Before the world was ever formed, you and I were in the heart and mind of a holy God, knowing exactly what would need to occur in order for our sins to be forgiven and for us to have an eternity in heaven. We were on his mind, we were in his heart before the world was ever formed. Ladies and gentlemen, it is so important for us to see that he has prayed and prayed and prayed for us. He knew that we were lost and that we needed a Savior. He knew that man was incapable of saving himself. He knew that there had to be a sinless sacrifice, and he knew that he was the only one that could pay man's sin debt. And there that day, he cried to his Father. He prayed for those who were his enemies. What a demonstration of love we see here as Jesus called on the Father on behalf of sinners. Let me clear something up this morning for everyone that's under the sound of my voice. He is the sinner's best friend, praying to the Father even as he is dying, he prays. Think with me along these lines. No longer can his hands reach out and minister to the sick. They're nailed. No longer can his feet take him into a town where people are in need of healing. No longer can he instruct his disciples through parables that teach the kingdom of heaven. They've forsaken him. What then can he do? Yes, he could have called 10,000 angels to deliver him that day, but instead he chose to hang there in shame and in agony, suffering humiliation unlike anything we will ever know. So what can he do? What did he do? He prayed to his Father. I must point out that this verse starts with the word then. And I'm not trying to get so technical about all of these things, but then, the verse says, then when man had done his worst, then when wicked hands had crucified the King of glory, then when he was wounded for our transgressions, when he was bruised for our iniquities, when the chastisement of our peace was upon him, then is when he prayed to his Father. Then. His first statement from the cross is a prayer. But the second statement that I want you to see, the second truth about this statement that I want you to see today is that his statement from the cross is a prayer for forgiveness. What a glorious word is the word forgiveness. It is a word that tells how the record of offenses that are attached to our names can be made clean. It explains that those who are guilty can go free. Oh, how wonderful is the word forgiveness. It is a word that Jesus utters here, and in asking his Father to forgive, Jesus was asking the best possible thing. This is the case because forgiveness means far more than being let off from a penalty. Forgiveness is the restoration of a fellowship. When God forgives, ladies and gentlemen, he takes us back into his fellowship and walks with us as if we had never sinned. He makes a divine choice of his will to forget our past. Now, maybe I need to say that again, and everybody smile when I say that. He makes a divine choice of his will to forget our past. Listen to me. I know that God is omnipotent. He is all-powerful. But he makes, Brother Brian, a divine choice to forget what we have done. Think with me about that. You know, sometimes our minds are wonderful things. Sometimes they're dreadful things. Sometimes you remember things from 50 years ago. Brother Ron, in your case, never mind. You remember things from 50 years ago, but you can't remember where you parked your car. God the Father makes a divine choice. Brother Brian, he chooses not to remember. He chooses not to remember what we have done when he forgives us of our sins. Regardless of how ungodly and how unworthy we are, forgiveness means that we are now accepted and that we have access to the throne room. The scriptures are filled with verses that speak of forgiveness. But they all come about as a result of God in love being merciful and gracious towards us because of Jesus. Look at these verses with me this morning. Ephesians 1, verse number 7, the Word of God says, "In whom we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of His grace." How about Hebrews 8, verse number 12? "For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more." How about 1 John 1, 9? "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." It must be mentioned this morning that in praying, "Father, forgive," Jesus was acting as an intercessor. This is also the perfect fulfillment of the prophecy from Isaiah 53, verse 12, where the Bible says, "And He was numbered with the transgressors, and He bare the sins of many and made intercession for the transgressors." Brother Dave, while dying, he is praying that his Father would forgive those who have put him to death. The first statement from the cross is a prayer. The first statement from the cross is a prayer for forgiveness. And by the way, there is no question in Christ's mind as to whether or not God would forgive. It's a done deal. In this prayer, we see that Jesus is fully confident that forgiveness is available. Again, we see that he was interceding, praying that sinners would be converted. It is important that we understand that there is no forgiveness without there first being conversion. Jesus believed with all confidence that the worst of sinners, even his most bitter enemies, could be forgiven if they would just come by way of the cross. And he prayed, "Father, forgive." His first statement is a prayer for forgiveness. But his first statement from the cross, thirdly today, it's a prayer for forgiveness for those who had wronged him. It's clearly seen in the words in Luke 23, 34, "Father, forgive them." But just who is it that had wronged Christ? I want you to dwell on that thought for just a minute. Who is it that had wronged Jesus? Was it the Pharisees and the priests who were responsible for having him arrested? Was it the Roman soldiers who were responsible for physically nailing him to the cross? Just who exactly is responsible? Who killed Jesus? Who's responsible? Is it Pilate? Is it Herod? Is it the high priest? Is it the Romans? Is it the Jews? Let's give the answer in very simple terms. We all are responsible. All of humanity shares complicitly in the guilt of Jesus' death. Because, ladies and gentlemen, it was not his sins that caused him to die on the cross. It was my sins and your sins. It was all of us who are to blame for him dying the manner in which he did. We are all responsible for his death, for we have all sinned, and he, the sinless Son of God, was dying for the sins of all. And I want you to see that Jesus was one that definitely practiced what he preached. You know, that's one of the things that you hear so often. Yes, it often gets leveled at preachers. Practice what you preach. But you know, it gets leveled at Christians. You know, that if we say we believe the Bible, well, practice what you preach. Let's realize something this morning. Jesus definitely practiced what he preached. You say, what are you talking about, Pastor? Look at Matthew 5, verse number 44. On one occasion, he spoke these words, "Love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." I need you to understand something today. As we hear Jesus praying, "Father, forgive them," we know that what he preached on the sunny slopes of the Sermon on the Mount, he put into practice on the dark hillside of Calvary. Christianity is not just something that we practice in the light. It's something that we practice even when it gets dark. And Jesus did it. You'll find that his prayer, "Father, forgive them," began to be answered that very day. In that very hour, God began to save souls. The thief on the cross looked to Jesus and asked to be remembered, and he was promised that he would be in paradise with Jesus. And the scriptures tell us that even the centurion that carried out the execution, the one who had watched the whole scene, the whole sacrifice, that the centurion steps back and says, "Truly, this was the Son of God." Yet this prayer was answered then. It was answered when the Spirit of God came on the day of Pentecost. It was answered when Peter finished preaching. 3,000 souls were saved. Here's how this works, Brother Jim. On Pentecost, one sermon was preached and 3,000 people get saved. Today, we preach 3,000 sermons and pray that one gets saved. Jesus' prayer got answered that day on the cross. It got answered that day at Pentecost. It got answered when Peter preached. It was the prayer of the Savior when he was on the cross and the power of the Holy Spirit. It wasn't the eloquence of Peter's words that day that caused 3,000 people to come to Christ. It was an answer to the prayer that was prayed. I can imagine the scene on the day of Pentecost. Peter has finished preaching, and a man runs up to him. And he says, I spat on him as he was carrying his cross through Jerusalem. Is there any hope for me? Another says, I ridiculed him and I cried out, crucify him. Is there any hope for me? I can imagine as another says, I thrust the spear into his side. Is there any hope for me? Can you see the hardened fisherman preacher Peter as he stands there on the day of Pentecost? I can imagine him saying to each one of them, I have good news. Repent of your sins. Put your trust in Jesus and you will be saved. He does not want any of you to perish. He died for you. He prayed for you. He loves you. Sitting here this morning, you're saying, Pastor, you don't understand what I've done. You don't know about my life. You don't know where I've been. You don't know what I have been into. And you may be wondering in your own heart, is there any hope for me? Oh, I've got good news for you. On the cross, Jesus said, Father, forgive them. And that prayer was answered that day. Brother Brian, it was answered on Pentecost. It has been answered and answered and answered for 2,000 years still, and it still can be answered today if you will put your faith and trust in Jesus as your only way to go to heaven. That prayer can be answered for you today. Believe on the name of the Son of God, and thou shalt be saved. When all hope seems lost, when it doesn't appear as if there is any chance of there being peace and joy that would ever happen in your life, Jesus has prayed for you, and He wants to have a personal relationship with you. The first statement on the cross reminds us that it was a prayer to His Father for forgiveness for those that had wronged Him. Maybe today's the first time that you've ever come face to face with the fact that you, that I, that humanity has wronged God. I read something this past week that really put it into perspective for me, because you see, today people want to talk about religion. About how that, well, Brother Dave's a religious person. He comes to church, or he does this. Or Brother Charles is a religious person. He dresses up in a suit and tie. My four-year-old thinks that everybody who wears a suit and tie goes to church somewhere. Every time he sees someone with a suit and tie on, he wants to know where they go to church. And if they don't tell him anywhere that they do, he says, "You can come to Calvary Baptist Church." We won't talk about religion. Religion says that if you do this, and if you do this, and if you do this, and if you do this, then everything will be fine. That's what religion says. In fact, religion, when you don't do those things, religion makes you feel bad. You get upset because you have broken a religious law. But a relationship is something completely different. God doesn't want you to have religion. He wants you to have a relationship with Him. Because a relationship, when we realize, oh, it's not about breaking some religious law, it's about breaking God's heart. I want you to know something this morning. God loves you so much that He sent His only Son to die for you. That whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Can I invite you to bow your heads and hearts with me today? Please make no mistake. Jesus was praying for you that day. He was praying that you would accept Him as your only way to go to heaven. He was praying that you would trust in Him and not something else. Oh, and ladies and gentlemen, I want to implore you, why not come and accept the forgiveness that Jesus has purchased for you today? And Christian, let me ask you, when was the last time you thanked Him for forgiving you of your sins, for making a way, the only way, for you to go to heaven?